Postgres or MySQL. I've used both, and let me tell you, they have a lot in common. But they also have deep differences beyond the simple technical specs. By the end of this video, you'll have a clear picture of which database fits your learning style, your personality, and your project needs. Let's dive in. Before we explore the differences, it's worth looking at what Postgres and MySQL have in common. Because at their core, both Postgres and MySQL speak the same language. There's a Q in the SQL part of the name. It's like the difference between us Brits and Americans. Sure, some words are different, like holidays and vacations or trousers and pants, but the core of the language is the same. This shared foundation means that if you're comfortable with one language, you're most of the way to mastering the other. They're not even two languages. Postgres and MySQL, they're two dialects of a common language, SQL. Postgres and MySQL provide the same basic syntax to create, read, update, and delete data. Both databases are relational database management systems, or RDMSs. They both organize data into tables with relationships. They're both open source. They both have strong community support and are constantly improving. They both provide data backup and replication features. So if they have so much in common, what justifies choosing one over the other? Well, the truth be told, these commonalities mean that for most projects and for most use cases, it doesn't make that much of a difference which you choose. Both do the simple things well, and both are good choices. I personally started out by learning MySQL. Once I had that, learning Postgres was easy. The shared SQL foundation meant I could apply most of my existing knowledge, and I quickly picked up the differences. Because there are differences, but they lie below the surface. You see, Postgres and MySQL have fundamentally different DNAs and histories. If I were to boil down the opposition between the two databases down to one simple contrast to two different strengths, it would be that MySQL is simpler and Postgres is richer. Now, both of these have trade-offs. One is like homemade cooking, the other is like a sophisticated meal cooked up by a fancy chef. Both are good, depending on the context. Both are worth having, but there are situations where I prefer one over the other. MySQL does simple things well. This makes it easier to learn, to use, and to understand. Postgres has more features and goes beyond the strict definition of an SQL database. This adds complexity. It's harder to master. MySQL is a pure RDMS. It's perfect for learning how SQL and RDMSs work. For a lot of applications, the feature set is more than enough. It's what I use at work. It's straightforward. It has a simple mental model, and that simplicity is a strength. MySQL only supports straightforward data structures. That constraint helps structure how we build and makes choices easier. MySQL's structure teaches you the rules of database normalization and data structuring. Postgres, on the other hand, is richer, but that also means more complex. It's not just an RDMS, it's an Object Relational Database Management System, or ORDMS. Let's take a second to explore what that means. Postgres blurs the lines between traditional databases and object-oriented programming. For example, you can define a type for a table and then inherit that type on a different table. Postgres can also handle more complex relationships and offers an extensive range of built-in and custom data types, including arrays and JSONB. This allows for more complex data modeling out of the box, which allows for easier mapping to objects in your code. This also means it's easy to break normalization rules. In a sense, Postgres is a NoSQL database if we take the NO to mean not only. Now, these differences have real-world implications. MySQL's simplicity makes it a popular choice for starting out and for simple applications. It's the database of choice for content management systems like WordPress. It's perfect for learning SQL. It works very well in an OLTP context. Now, wait a second, what does that mean? Well, OLTP stands for Online Transactional Processing. In other words, managing purchases and financial transfers and accounting, basically the e-commerce and banking use cases. Postgres shines in scenarios requiring complex query processing and data manipulation. For example, Postgres allows you to create materialized views, which are cached results of complex queries. This significantly boosts performance for frequently accessed data. In short, Postgres does better than MySQL in OLAP, scenarios. OLAP stands for Online Analytical Processing. In other words, when you want to show a complex dashboard, think Google Analytics, although they probably don't use Postgres. To state things differently, Postgres is the tool of choice when you're building a data warehouse. Postgres does offer more features, but that means more opportunities to get tripped up. For example, to handle concurrency, that's how well a database handles multiple operations at once, Postgres uses a multiple version concurrency control in MVCC without any read-write locks. However, for certain very limited use cases, these complex features have an overhead. For example, in 2016, Uber explained in detail that they were dropping Postgres for performance reasons. Now, their use case was very specific, and you probably won't ever encounter anything similar. But if you want a deep dive into how Postgres indexing and concurrency control work, I recommend reading the blog post that I've linked to in the description. Now, let's talk about ACID compliance, and I have a video here if you want to dive deeper into what ACID compliance means. Postgres fully supports ACID compliance across all configurations. In MySQL, you can use weird storage engines like CSV or in-memory storage, or even one called black hole that you can write to but not read from. Obviously, those aren't ACID compliant. However, InnoDB, which is what most people mean when they refer to MySQL, is ACID compliant. We've explored the commonalities and differences between Postgres and MySQL. So, which should you choose? Which should you use? What should you learn first? Well, obviously the answer is, it depends. It depends on who you are, where you're at, and what you're building. But thankfully, there are cases where I can give you a clear answer. If you're learning SQL, or if you want to build a basic blog or an e-commerce website, I recommend sticking with MySQL. MySQL shines in simplicity and speed. It makes it ideal for many web applications. It'll provide all the features that you need, and limiting yourself to MySQL will help focus any data architecture questions. You need to start simple, basically. Postgres certainly supports the basics just as well as MySQL, but if your brain works like mine and gets easily distracted, you might want to do without the added distraction of the advanced features. That being said, even for simple apps, if you're building on the edge, for example with Next.js, you'll find a lot more Postgres solutions available. There is PlanetShare, which is a hosted distributed MySQL database, but going with Postgres gives you the choice between Superbase and Neon and Xata, and of course Vercel's own offering. If you want to provide advanced analytics or data warehousing, then choosing Postgres makes much more sense than MySQL. Postgres offers robust features for complex operations, making it perfect for data-intensive projects. And in general, if you're, say, outside any of these specific cases, well, in that case, I'd recommend Postgres. Why? Because it does the simple things just as well as MySQL does. Because it's gaining popularity and market share and is now the leading database in the Stack Overflow survey. And because if your application grows and needs the advanced features that it provides, you won't need to migrate. But if you prefer MySQL, that's perfectly fine too. I've provided links to related resources in the description, and I'll see you in this next video.